First of all, good morning, everybody. So, first of all, I would like to thank the organizers for Luca and Alexei for inviting me. So, I speak about some interesting phenomena which we predicted first time together with Viktor Rubin, and now we have numerical confirmation of breaking phenomena in incompressible fluid. So you know that the breaking phenomena is intrinsic for compressible fluids. It's for gases, for instance, and therefore it looks like something unexpected, because if you have incompressible fluid, but there exists some compressible entity. And it's some look like a crazy question or something like that. But however, it's some background for understanding how the turbulence arising, first of all, developed dynamic turbulence. And it turns out that there exists some understanding how Kolmogorov and Christian spectra appear. So, it doesn't matter what is the dimension, it's a very crucial point. And it's connected with compressible entity. And in three-dimensional case, it's a vorticity. So vorticity can be compressed. And therefore, it gives some new understanding what can happen. And in two-dimensional case also, it looks like something strange, because we know that for Euler case, when you work in an inertial interval, then you have a vorticity itself, and it's just a scalar, not passive active scalar, which moves together with fluid, and it's constant. Yeah. But however, it turns out if you consider curl or rotor from vorticity, you will get so-called d-vorticity, and d-vorticity lines can be compressible also. And it's something unusual. Okay, so it's some plan. So because we know that in 2D case you have no formation of singularity in finite time, it's a theorem. And therefore, I will use, instead of breaking, folding. Folding means that I prefer, because folding means that you have a not appearance in a singularity in finite time, but as we demonstrated in our numerics, we have an exponential increasing of vorticity. So this is a plan of my talk. Now I start just from motivation. So well-known facts about Kolmogorov spectrum and Kolmogorov theory is based on that inertial interval turbulence must be isotropic and homogeneous. It's a very important nonlinear interaction in this interval must be local and is defined by energy flux only. And from another side, it's well known that if you have some singularity, singularity gives the power type behavior for real amplitudes and provides the appearance of power tails of turbulence spectrum. And therefore, it's somehow natural to connect such type of tails with some singularity. And let's look at on the Kolmogorov theory from this point of view. You can use the usual dimensional analysis, and it follows immediately that the time energy transfer from large scales to dissipative ones is finite, and it's defined by such a formula. And from another side, distribution of velocity with the scale r, it's a well-known formula. It's proportional to r in thirds, And if you consider the vorticity, you have a singularity as r tends to zero. And besides, there is finite, and therefore the question is the following. Is it a real singularity? Is it possible to say that Kolmogorov spectrum appears as a result of collapse or formation of singularity in a finite time? And in fact, it was a motivation of our papers, which I want to present here. So in this paper, we demonstrated using the so-called vortex line representation I tell about, what's it, and direct numerical integration of 3D Euler. We show that at the stage of turbulent horizon, the spectrum is very far from isotropic. It's a very interesting results, but the main contribution to the spectrum in 3D is connected with the appearance of coherent structure of the pancake type. And first time such structure were observed in numerical experiment by Marc Brachet in 1992. And the maximum pancake vorticity and the result connected by means of a Kolmogorov type relation, which I demonstrated, so it's some technical point. Then what I told already is that the appearance of a pancake structure or is connected with compressibility of vortex lines and you can see consequence of folding or breaking of the vorticity lines. And so possibility of such folding, breaking is connected with compressibility of vortex line and it was predicted in our paper with Victor Rubin. Then what we observed also in our numerics that increasing with time number of such structures leads to formation of Kolmogorov energy spectrum observed numerically in the full inviscid flow without tendency towards finite time blow up. Now there is some naive arguments why you have to expect blow up behavior just for Euler equation because of we work in an inertial interval. So if you consider omega max how it behaves and it, and if you assume that this derivative in the maximum point is proportional to alpha multiplied by omega max, you will get immediately such type of behavior. But unfortunately, such naive arguments break down because of, as it's well known, that the Euler equation contains an infinite number of integrals of motion. It's just a Kernel theorem says that the circulation for arbitrary contour moving together with fluid is invariant, but less known about so-called Cauchy invariant, which can be obtained from this formula if you introduce the usual Lagrangian variables and then rewrite this circulation in terms of A it's a Lagrangian marker, and then it turns out that the curl of integral integrand will be Cauchy invariance. So it's interesting that Cauchy predicted this invariance before Kelvin proved this theorem. It seems to me 20 years difference in it. So it's a very interesting phenomenon. But the most important point in the following that such invariants are connected with the frozenness of the vorticity into fluid. This means that fluid particles cannot leave its own vertex line and then move together with the fluid. But from another side, it follows immediately that any motion alone vertex line cannot change vorticity because of vector product. And this means that it's necessary to decompose the velocity by two components, normal and tangent component velocity. And it turns out that the Euler equation in such a case can be written in such very exciting form, where E and H are electric and a magnetic field, like in electrodynamics. And phi, it's written here, and the vector potential is nothing more than the tangent component of velocity. So what we have? Normal component velocity is nothing more as a velocity of vortex line because of frozenness. So this means that you have a motion, but divergent BN in such a case is not equal to zero. So this means that you have a new presentation representation for Euler equation. And it's a very interesting observation, and then you can introduce in such new dynamics, new Lagrangian trajectory, which defined by the normal component of velocity, and then it turns out that that you have a in Lagrangian formulation, you have as the usual Hamiltonian equations where H is given by the usual expression for energy moving in electromagnetic field, and so it's written. And then it turns out that there exists a Kerlin or Liouville theorem, which says that this circulation must be invariant, and as a result, you get new Cauchy invariant. The most important point is the following, that this formula can be rewritten in such a form where Jacobian standing in denominator is not fixed. It can be changed because of divergence Vn in such a case is not equal to zero. Therefore, this means that vorticity lines can be compressible entity, so you can compress. And if it's so, then this means that you have something new physically, if it's possible to say. For instance, if you introduce the quantity which inverse to Jacobian in minus 1, then you will get the usual continuity equation. But the divergence Vn in such a case is not equal to 0, and therefore we have compressible entity. And as we know in gas dynamics, compressibility of gases leads to formation of breaking, but it happens in finite time. But the most important point of the remark is too, that breaking and vortex line is impossible in 2D and cylindrically symmetric flows without swirl. And so, for instance, in such a case, omega is perpendicular V, and divergent V in such a case is equal to 0. And consequently, Jacobian is equal to 1, and therefore, you have no appearance of a zero in denominator. If it's so, in fact it's a simple observation. Why we started to perform numerics is because we expect a formation of singularity due to vanishing of Jacobian, but it is not so. It happens probably in infinite time, so this Jacobian exponential decreasing in time, and therefore, but however, we observe a very big amplification of the vorticity from the initial volume. So the question is, what does it mean breaking in such a case? Breaking in such a case means that one vortex line touches another. Like in usual, Burgers equation with zero viscosity, when you know that each particle can move with a constant velocity, but can reach another. When you have a touching, then you have appearance of gradient catastrophe and infinite gradient in such a case. So in principle, you have some point where you have a touching. And near this touching, it's possible to expand Jacobian because of the main idea is the following. Let's consider how Jacobian behaves in time. So you have a touching point, A is equal to A zero, but the most important point is the following. I don't know how this function, it's a minimum value of Jacobian, behaves as a function of time. And what we can do, we can take this dependence from numerics, but so this means that T0 can be infinity, and it seems to me it's what numerics gives us. And this matrix, gamma ij, is positive definite, though, so you have a quadratic terms, which corresponds to just two minimum, and it's a more or less general situation in such a case. And if we assume that the main contribution to maximum vorticity region comes from the minimum of Jacobian, then we arrive to such formula. And the most important point is the following: that in our Lagrangian space, we have self-similarity behavior. So you have a compression in all direction proportional to tau in half. And omega will increase in time like 1 divided by tau. But I would like to repeat that tau here, it's some function which can be found from numerical experiment. Now the main problem is the following. It's necessary to, because if I work in auxiliary space, then it's necessary to come back to physical space. Let's consider what we have just for one-dimensional situation. In such case, the Jacobian is nothing more than the derivative dx dA, and A here, it's I put A0 is equal zero, so you have a such type of equation which can be integrated, and the result you can see that you have a scaling in auxiliary space, you have a proportional to tau in half, and in physical space you have a more rapid compression, it's proportional to tau in 3 over 2. Next observation is the following. If I consider far from, so let's consider such type of limit, in such a case it follows immediately that the Jacobian will be proportional to x 2 over 3, and it's such type of indexes comes from the usual, it's the usual, in fact, folding. Yeah, yeah, right. But of course, for Berger's case with a zero viscosity, it is follows. So tau in, but here it doesn't matter. What I would like to mention that it's a function tau, I assume that tau is small. If tau is small, then I can get such type of dependence. Finally, what we have in 3D? In 3D case, Jacobian is a product of eigenvalues. And if Jacobian tends to zero, then this means that one eigenvalue tends to zero, two others tends to constant, and therefore we have two different directions. One is a soft direction alone, corresponding to lambda 1, where you have a behavior like in 1D, so x1 is proportional to tau in 3 over 2. And then you have two other directions, perpendicular, in fact, proportional to tau in half. So that you have a such type of self-similarity in physical space. And it's nothing more as appearance of pancake. So if you compare, if you look at last papers by Zildovich, you can find so-called pancake theory for appearance of protogalaxies, and it's a very exciting papers. And so what you have here, we have here the following structure, that in transverse direction to pancake, we have a very rapid compression is proportional to tau in 3 over 2, and slow compression in this direction. So it results in the appearance of a pancake behavior. So what is the main reason of appearance of such? It's connected with the compressibility only. So I assume that vertex line can be compressed. And in general situation, you have to get such type of such pancake structure. And of course, when you are far from a singular point, then in such a case, you arrive to Kolmogorov type dependence for vorticity. So you have a such type of singular behavior. But in transverse direction, you have another behavior. And therefore, it's possible also to extract how the vorticity, in maximum vorticity, behaves as a width of pancake. Because of omega is proportional to tau in minus 1, from another side we know that L of t is proportional also, but it's such type of power. So it follows immediately from estimation which I demonstrated before. So you have to expect appearance of such type of law. So when omega tends to infinity and L tends to but you have a Kolmogorov type behavior, but this behavior appears as a result of folding. It's a very crucial point. So connected with the compressibility. From another side, it follows that If you consider enumerator, we have a such type of behavior. You have a Jacobian acting on the initial vorticity, and if you expand the Jacobian through projections, then one projection is small because of lambda, 1 tends to 0, and therefore it follows immediately that vertex line representation in fact predicts that pancake structure, the vorticity must lie in the pancake plane. So it's also interesting point. And now I would like to say about what you have in numerics. First of all, we solve Euler equations for vorticity. We have two numerical scheme which connected with direct integration of the Euler equation for vorticity and vertex line representation in periodic box, so it's a box, and then we use a such type of initial condition. It looks like a ABC flow when the two coefficient BC equals 0, and plus some noise spectrum of such noise is concentrated at small k. And in this paper, I presented the result concerning the final grid. But it's interesting that this final grid is not cube, but and it's connected with some numerical findings. So by the way, so maybe later I can show you what you have. What we obtain? First of all, we obtain formation of the pancake structure where the omega max is proportional to L minus 2/3. So it's a law, in fact. Then Fitting showed exponential increasing of the maximum vorticity in respect to exponential. So we have no tendency to break up, to break in, to appearance of a singularity in finite time. Then, using vertex line representation scheme, we demonstrated that decreasing of the Jacobian, so it gives us some proof that indeed, in three-dimensional case, you have compressible entity. And this entity is nothing more as a vorticity lines. Then, with time, we found that number of such structures increases, and that this leads to Kolmogorov energy spectrum in some intermediate scale. Not for larger scale in K-space, but for some intermediate scales. It's also a very interesting result. Now this is a result of numerics, so you can see a pancake, but it's a pancake. It looks like as a sum, I don't know, some saddle, but it is not so because of scales here. So it's a demonstration that it's three-dimensional figure. It's not one-dimensional indeed, and therefore we have a such type of scales along perpendicular to our vortex layer. And what else? Secondly, what we see that how maximum vorticity behaves in time. So you can see a lot of pancakes, more or less.
Sorry,
what?
This is the global maximum?
Yeah, so you have a global maximum, but we have another local maximum, which also represents pancake structures. So you have a lot of pancake structures, and we have, in some sense, statistics. And for all of them, we observed exponential increasing of maximum vorticity. And it follows, so it's so green line here corresponds to the global maximum, how global maximum corresponded to the main pancake. And so you can see that it's so Fitting show that you have a such type of behavior, exponentially increasing for pancake. But for all others also you can see, for all others, so you can see that you have a parallel almost with the same or less time t omega approximately is equal to. So I don't know why, but this is a result of numerics. Finally, we have three scales, L1, L2, and 3. L1 corresponded to the widths, and so you can see that you have an exponential decreasing, sorry, it's exponential decreasing, but as far as L2 and L3, they are more or less constant. So you have a pancake appearance for large. Then, what yes, yes, without viscosity. So I solve only Euler equation, nothing more.
You stop before you reach.
So in principle, so I didn't include it. I didn't include that viscosity. There is some hyperviscosity, but we use hyperviscosity in order to kill some numerical instability.
And it is not forced. It's just a decay.
Yeah. It's just a decay. But however, the most interesting point that we start with some initial condition, and then you have a decay without any viscosity, and then we can see that development of results in appearance of pancake structure, a lot of. So we observe, so from the very beginning, we have maybe three maxions, and in final time, we have about 15 maxions. All of them look like, so I show you what you have here. What?
Energy is conserved during evolution.
Yes. So what we can see that how the maximum vorticity for each pancake depends on its width. And so you have
what? Sorry. Can you tell me again how do you define L1, the width? In the numerics, how do you define it?
How you define? It's easy. So you have a maximum, so maximum vorticity.
No, L1, the maximum, I understand, but
L1. L1 is the width.
Sorry?
Width. Width and thickness.
It's not so well defined because the structure is.
No. Yeah. You're right, but because it's necessary. It's near maximum. Near maximum, you can expand it, and then consider the second derivative. So yeah, and after that, you can extract what is it? L1, L2, L3, and so you have orthogonal system of coordinates, etc. So these are such a so and. So the most important point is the following, that we establish such type of law, so Kolmogorov type, but appearance of such type of law is not connected with the usual picture following, I don't know, naive arguments about when you have one vortex and then you have a appearance of two vortices, etc. So you have a direct cascade, but here you can see that we have something different. So what we have is a component, omega 1, omega 2, and omega 3. So they are oriented with respect to maximum, and then you have a quadratic, and so so one component is large enough, two others more or less constant, and therefore you can see that such type of behavior we have. So this means that vorticity lies on the pancake plane, and it's important. Finally, what we found also that we have a self-similar behavior for pancake drive. So you can see that it's for different times, and then we have a self-similarity. Yeah. The next point, what we checked also, the most important point that by using direct integration, we found that the maximum vorticity point is proportional to minus the divergence Vn. And we checked this relation. More or less, it's because of it follows from more or less. So we checked and established that growth rate for omega max is connected with divergence Vn. But divergence Vn, it's a characteristic of compressibility of body class. So for direct integration, for direct scheme of integration of Euler equation, we established such type of relation. And this means that the main contribution to viscosity comes from denominator. In fact, we demonstrated this fact for this case. The second point is connected how the spectrum look like in our numerics. First of all, because if you have a one pancake, another pancake, and in case space you have a jet structure. And so you can see here it's a direction for many, many, many pancakes, and each pancake gives such type of jet. The most important point is the following, that somewhere here you have a overlapping between jets. And just for this region, we obtain Kolmogorov power type behavior. But It's a region where you have a lot of pancakes and somewhere in some region you have an overlapping between them.
You do spectrum.
Yeah.
Would be for the whole space or it's not wavelet locally?
No. It's not wavelet. It's a spectrum averaging with respect to angle, of course. So we average.
Yeah, but Fourier you do by summing over the whole R space.
Yes, the whole R space. Yeah.
So
it,
what does it mean the statement that in this region the spectrum
is the following? So let's look at here. You can see one pancake, another pancake, and here we can see evidently that we have some overlapping. And it turns out just in this region, for this region, we obtain. Yes, in K space, it's in K space. Just for this region, we obtain Kolmogorov type law. And here it's a maximum K. K which proportional to omega max, et cetera, in corresponding power. But here you can see that for intermediate scales, it's a very interesting phenomenon. So when you have a overlapping between pancakes or between jets, then we have a Kolmogorov type behavior.
Sorry.
It's a Kolmogorov spectrum. So Kolmogorov spectrum appears for intermediate scales, not for larger scales. And secondly, what we see that in turbulence arising, following to our numerics, we have a very increasing anisotropy for each pancake. And anisotropy increases with time. It's also interesting observation. Now let me consider what.
Excuse me, ask you a question.
Okay.
About this part before. So are you going to say that Kolmogorov spectrum is due to evolution of one pancake, or it's appear
due to interaction?
Due to interaction.
So if you take just one pancake, and then we know how it behaves as a function of coordinates, etc. It's possible to extract from arguments which I presented before, and then it turns out that that here we have another kind of behavior. It's proportional to k minus. A divided by 3.
Because you angle average.
Yeah. Not only. So for each you have a such type of behavior. For very large k, you have a such type of asymptotic from the main, because the main contribution comes from the maximal pancake. And it gives us such a power k minus 8 over 3. But for intermediate scale, what was very interesting and unexpected for us, we have a Kolmogorov type behavior. But it comes when you have an overlapping overlapping of one jet and with another. So you have a jet, and then overlapping between them results in appearance of Kolmogorov. Okay. But it's for fully in viscid case. So viscosity is equal to zero. That then in just in the Euler equations.
Can one get this 5/3 out of 8/3 just by adding unity, namely that you have minus 8/3 and k comes out of phase volume of different.
Yeah, right. It's something like that. Of course, here you have some region where you have one behavior and another behavior, but now we have so look at Kolmogorov spectrum here is observed for one decade only. Yeah, it's not enough resolution, unfortunately. Now we have numerics with 2,000s in cube grid, so it's by the way, I should say that to perform such a numerics of one variant needs for us about maybe 2 months or something like that, you can imagine. So it's a very hard numerical.
Can you show the previous slide 1 second, because I missed one part, the slide, the previous one?
What?
The previous slide, the one before this.
Before this, okay.
So
we know that if we consider one pancake gives such type of jets in K space. So it's a jet. Because of structure is very anisotropic and radiated, I don't know, in one angle. And therefore you have to expect in perpendicular, like I don't know, when you consider radiation from antenna. So you have antenna, and then it turns out immediately that if you have a very big antenna, then you have to get something. In fact, it's a diagram for propagation. I don't know. It's for antenna, and the same situation takes place here. So you have one jet, which corresponds to the main pancake. Then we have another pancake, which is directed in K-space, it's a maximum value. So it's this direction. Then you have another pancake, and so on and so on. And so we observe here, for this time, we have observed about maybe 13 pancakes. But the most important point is the following, that near region, we have an intersection between them, overlapping. And this overlapping can be considered as interaction between vertices. And for such scales, just for these scales, we have, after averaging over angles, we have a Kolmogorov spectrum. Okay? Now I have a 20 minutes to finish something I should say about two-dimensional turbulence. So we know that there is this so-called Kretschmann spectrum, and here I would like to discuss only Kretschmann spectrum. And it's a well-known expression. It's enstrophy flux because of enstrophy is a constant of motion in such a case. But and this spectrum was predicted by Kretschmann in 1967. But in 1971, Safman suggested another spectrum proportional to k minus 4. And the main idea was the following, that if you consider the first numerical experiment by Lilly, first of all, then there were many others numerical experiments. They demonstrated appearance of vorticity discontinuities, and if you consider such type of quasi shocks or discontinuities, then immediately follows that you have a behavior k minus 3. But if you consider such discontinuities, it's almost one-dimensional objects and with some scale L, And then it gives, in K-space, jet-like distribution with angular widths proportional to KL in minus 1. So the same arguments what I demonstrated before, appearance of jets due to pancake. But here the question is, how it's possible to obtain it? What is the physical arguments? Why you have to expect appearance of some singular, quasi-singular? Because we know that there exists a theorem forbidden appearance of singularity in finite time for two-dimensional case. And again, it's possible to establish the following fact. Let's consider such a vector. Omega here, it's a vorticity in two-dimensional flows, and then introduce such a, in fact, it's nothing more as a curl of omega, because omega is directed in that direction, and therefore it's possible to establish it. It's just exercise. If you take just a Euler equation and then consider how B behaves, then you again get such type of equation. So interesting point. So this means that B is called just d-vorticity. Again, can change due to normal component of velocity, normal component with respect to B. It's easy to see that this vector is tangent to the line omega x, y is constant.
And
yeah, in 2D, only in 2D. Only 2D. So this means that you have, some compressible entity. And it's a d-vorticity line. So a d-vorticity line can be compressed. And due to this compressibility appears, appearance of Jacobian. So we introduce again new trajectories by normal component of velocity. In fact, it's an analog of a vertex line representation, and you will get such type of formula. And Jacobian stands here. So the question is how this quantity behaves due to vanishing of Jacobian, et cetera, et cetera. And the first numerical experiment was presented in our paper with these guys in 2007. And we obtained that indeed increasing of d-vorticity can be connected with a compressibility property of d-vorticity lines. And now I would like to present results, recent results. So we solve this equation numerically, introduced by hyperviscosity, et cetera, et cetera. It's just for computer, and then it's our resolution. So we have two variants. One variant when you have a two-dimensional decay turbulence. So it looks like so it's initial condition, and then that results in the appearance of something like that. So we have a positive and negative vortex distribution of Gaussian type, et cetera, and then you can see what will happen with time. And what we found that if we consider the spectrum compensated by KQ or some, so you can see with time you have a plateau, and this plateau just corresponds to Kretschmann spectrum. But Kretschmann spectrum in such a case appears again due to compressible character of d-vorticity lines. So
no forcing.
And how for instance, distribution of B at time is equal to 100 look like? And so you can see it's very complicated. But however, if you consider how B depends on x, at y is equal to 0, then you can see that you have a very sharp peak. So in fact, so we start from, I don't know, B of order 10 or something like that, and here you have increasing into in 100 at least. So you have a very big increase. And so this means that what we have? We have the following, that if we look at, and if we resolve all of them, you can see that B represents such type of line. Between this line, you have almost nothing. So you have one line, another line, et cetera, et cetera. It's just a projection, and here you can see nothing. So it looked like a folding, that it's a structure with a lot of lines concentrated between them. You have almost noise, almost nothing. And so the first experiment shows, so it's just maximum of B, how it behaves for decay case. So you can see that we have, I don't know, three order of magnitudes or two order of magnitudes exactly, increasing of B.
Exponential
at the beginning. Exponential at the beginning, but somewhere here you have some saturation. But the most important point is the spectrum. So spectrum look like as a combination of jets. There is some overlapping between them. And if you integrate with respect to angles, then you get the Kretschmann spectrum. But I would like to repeat once more that Kretschmann spectrum appears as a result of breaking or folding, it's possible to say, or folding because of it happens in not in finite time. But however, the tendency is very, very big in some sense, which results in appearance of such type of structure. So you can see that spectrum look like very anisotropy. So we prove numerically that all kinds of such spectrum comes from such type of jets or such type of structures, which is leads. So you have in fact quasi shocks, and each quasi shock provides you such type of appearance, and we proved it exactly. So the spectrum k minus 3 comes from such quasi singularities, and it's important point. Now we in for the k case we also found how zeta n depends on n, so you can see. So you have a more or less usual behavior for, and we also found the next point. What we did? We perform numerical experiments with pumping and viscous type damping. So it's a real system. So I introduce gamma. Gamma it's a growth rate. At k is equal b, you have a pumping, and then for small k, you have a very very strong dissipation in order to kill inverse cascade. Then for k larger than b, such a growth rate is equal zero, and then we introduce viscous type decrement, which is proportional to k minus kc, and k zero is some small parameter, and so doing, we can govern the width of inertial interval, and we made such inertial interval maximally possible what we have in such type of numerics. What we see that it's initially, and then we can see that the energy tends to constant, entropy also tends to constant. So somewhere at this time we have almost stationary state, statistically stationary state. Again, we can see that if you consider how the spectrum behaves as a function of k, it turns out that you have a k minus 3, so you have three decays more or less, here, and we established that you have a K minus 3 spectrum with a very high accuracy. It's a usual Watiski distribution, like for decay case, and it looks like. But the most interesting point, how distribution will be for different times. So it's again, we have the same behavior for B. So you have a B concentrated along separate lines. Between them, you have almost nothing. And in fact, these figures demonstrated it evidently. So you can see again, very high values of B. So it's a gradient, in fact. And nothing between one line and another because of it's a projection. It's a projection along y is equal to 0.5. And you can see that you have a lot of lines, and between them you have nothing. So in some sense, it's possible to say that we repeated the situation for decay case. It's very familiar. But the most important point is the following again. So the spectrum looks like again. You have a lot of jets. The most interesting point how the correlation function of S3L, so it's a velocity increment behaves as a function of R. What we establish? We establish that situation here becomes very, very anisotropic. But the dependence on R is proportional to R, it's a separation length, is proportional to R in cube. So it's a very interesting. So the results of which you have are for isotropic case. But the constant and dependent linear with respect to eta, eta it's a flux of entropy. But the most important point is the following, that here you can see positive and negative values for each angle. But sorry. if you average with respect to angles, it turns out you have no the answer which you expect for isotropic case.
But is this average in time or?
No. In one fixed time. So it's a time I don't remember. T is equal to 20 or something like that. 200.
We
calculated the correlation function. The correlation function is when we average with respect to coordinates only, the usual. So in principle, it's necessary to average with respect to time or with respect to coordinates. So it turns out that when we average with respect to coordinates, we have such type of dependencies. But from another side, we know that ergodicity assumptions gives us that average with respect to time or with respect to coordinates must give the same result. But it is not so in this case.
But I don't understand. So you average with respect to coordinates
yes.
at a given time.
Yeah, at a given time.
But the forcing is fully isotropic.
The forcing is fully isotropic.
And you still see this strong anisotropy?
Yes. So you have a very strong oscillation with respect to angles. I don't know. Look at you have a spectrum. This is a spectrum in K-space. Is it isotropic or not? So you can see a lot of jets here. But the most interesting thing is the following. If you average the spectrum with respect to angles, it gives exactly the results obtained before us numerically with the same constant, Cretien constant, etc. So with a good accuracy.
This is because the forcing is isotropic only if you average in time too.
So we perform average with respect time also. So
then isotropic.
Yeah, no. Nevertheless, we have another answer. So the dependence on with respect to coordinates for this correlation function for S3L. So we have another answer, which is not isotropic. It seems to me it must be proportional to 1 over 8, as I remember. So 1 over 8 multiplied by A in cube multiplied by eta. It's exact answer. Grisha told about this, it seemed to me. All right. And but for another correlator, it doesn't matter. But here you have a such type of behavior. And therefore, the most interesting thing is the following, that you have a deviation, and big deviation. What we reached after average with respect to time, after average with respect to coordinates when we calculated such correlation function, but nevertheless, we didn't get answer for isotropic case.
But this might be because you lose a forcing that is a linear forcing in vorticity, so you might be locked on some particular wave numbers. If you have at some instant of time one wave number where vorticity is very intense, you force more that wave number, and therefore there is a sort of non-linear forcing that you use. I mean linear forcing, but that you use depending.
So. It's a typical situation. Wait. I understand what you're speaking. So, what we did in our numerics. First of all, my main idea was the following: it's necessary to get maximum possible inertial range. So, if you have a maximum possible range, then it turns out that you have no viscosity, so you have no pumping, and so pumping in some sense look like as a, you know, some boundary conditions gives you in K-space, and then you have a viscosity, then you have the whole interval and nothing more. So it's not the case which we discuss here when you have a forcing.
Or in for this, it's your forcing was like instability type multiplied by vorticity itself, or it was just a linear additive force which had to.
So the characteristic time. What is the characteristic time here? It's a, you have a maximum vorticity inverse proportional to characteristic time. And then it seems to me that we have about, I don't know, 20 or something like that, 20 times. So the main results which we obtain, so for such big time, when we establish appearance of that energy almost constant and entropy also, total, I mean, in statistical sense. And then we can see what we obtain as a result. And results is the following, that appearance of such type of quasi-shocks gives us anisotropy behavior. It's a very important. And physical reason of such type of anisotropy is connected with compressibility of the vorticity lines. And therefore, it seems to me it's maybe the main conjecture of our numerics. In some sense, both, yeah? In 3D and in 2D. Yeah?
It was a question. What kind of force do we have? Instability or external additive force?
In some sense, of course, we have a stable situation in some sense because of what you have. You have a forcing which I introduced due to pumping. What?
Can we return to the page, to the slide where you actually gave it? Because I just forgot. You have the omega dt was something times omega, right?
Yes. So we have a growth rate. It looks like the following. It's a growth rate. So you have a pumping, linear pumping. I don't know what is the physical reason, say, I don't know.
For example, it's very similar to what we discovered with Vladimirova, that if you have a forcing which is type of a growth rate, it has a tendency to produce anisotropic spectra. strongly anisotropic spectra. And when you replace this forcing, which is gamma omega, by just external force, which is independent on omega, then in our case, for nonlinear Schrödinger, we've seen that all this jet structure disappeared. A spectra was still the same. So it could be that this is something which is...
But however, what I'm doing here, so you can see that probably maybe there exists some breach of what you did in nonlinear Schrödinger, but however, it isotropic function. Isotropic.
Well, that's right, but any fluctuation,
I understand. So, I don't know. So, this is a numerical
result. This is known also in three dimensions. When we force in three dimensions, if you use a forcing that is an instability connected to the velocity field, it tends to produce a strongly anisotropic structure. That if you wait maybe infinite time, then they will destabilize and they go in another anisotropic structure, but then they are really screened.
Of course, I would like to, because of before we believe, it doesn't matter what kinds of pumping you consider. You can consider forcing, or maybe you can consider some instability which results in appearance of turbulence, et cetera, et cetera. And therefore, here we have a physical example in some sense. It's a different from the common situation, common numerics, when you have forcing and a chaotic forcing, when you have all scales, etc. But here you have an isotropic pumping, which is given by this linear growth rate, and then we obtain what we obtain, it's already know. It's yes?
The spectrum which you saw, this jet, it's in a given moment of time?
Yes.
Yes?
And if you will take
average
in time, the jets will disappear?
It's a good question, but however, so. Everything, wait. Everything depends, more or less becomes isotropic. More or less. Yeah, but however we believe in ergodic assumption. Yeah, you can average with respect to coordinates or with respect to time. You have to get the same answer. But it turns out that we have different answer. It's a question for me at least.
It's like Kolmogorov spectrum, which is turbulent, which is local, anisotropic, strongly anisotropic, globally anisotropic.
But I would like to repeat once more that we introduce some physical, I don't know, insight to turbulence arising, and it's connected with the compressibility of frozen in fluid fields, and it seems to me this is the most important point of all our investigations. Okay. I'm sorry. Thank you.